Welcome to Focus on Health, a series of educational programs highlighting current health issues sponsored by the Department of Nursing at Salisbury University. I'm Dr. Mary DiBartolo, Professor of Nursing at Salisbury University and host of the program. I welcome back Cheryl Sinkbell. You work at Mack Incorporated, and you've been on the program before.
Yes, I have. It's been a while, but yes, I have. Thank you for the invitation.
Well, I'm so glad you could come in to talk about a very important topic, serious and important, and that's elder abuse. And we're going to do part one of a show on this topic because your focus as an ombudsman for Mack Incorporated is to deal with incidents that occur in long-term care or nursing homes. But before we get into the specifics of that, let's talk a little bit about, you know, exactly what elder abuse is. There's different types, and what are some of the numbers?
Sure. Elder abuse, you know, as a Maryland definition, talks about that it's to a vulnerable adult. And a vulnerable adult is someone who's 18 or over, and because of physical or mental reasons, they're dependent on their help with care for their activities of daily living, bathing, dressing. So it's a malicious or cruel or inhumane act that's been done against that adult.
And it can be physical or verbal. There's many types of it. So let's talk about some of the different forms that it takes.
Sure. There are examples would be the physical abuse. People think that's the most common. It's not probably the most common that I see, but physical abuse, people think of bruises, marks, scratches, burns, pain. Someone's inflicted pain upon them. Rough handling, even with trying repositioning kind of things. I think people think physical is one that people just, I don't know, they see it in movies or TV or something. They see the black and blue marks or something. But there are many other types as well. Verbal, you might hear the term emotional abuse.
Is that the most common, the verbal, emotional?
What I see in long-term care nursing homes, I believe it is. You might hear the term psychological abuse or mental or verbal. Someone who's been talking to someone in a very unkind way. And doesn't have to be cursing. It can be cursing, but foul language, but a lot of times it's someone who's being threatened, embarrassed, humiliated, talked down to, ignored, belittled, just made them feel really small and made them feel bad about themselves.
So demeaning and racial includes that as well.
Oh yeah, and sometimes, you know, calling somebody, you know, fat or racial slur or name or something like that, or even things like sometimes calling people honey and sweetie might seem appropriate, but it shows a lack of respect.
Right, we do a lot of training about that, especially for people with dementia. They can react very negatively to those terms, so
right.
We have to be careful with that as well.
Yeah. There's also, like, for example, sexual abuse. Don't see a lot of that, thank God. I think I've seen 2 cases in 17 years, so it's not been a lot. Of course, 1 case is 1 case too many.
Exactly.
But it doesn't have to be rape. It can be rape, but it could be just inappropriate touching without consent. Somebody being fondled or, again, touched inappropriately in their genitals or private area. Again, sometimes I've had a case one time where somebody inserted a toothbrush in someone inappropriately, sexually. So, I mean, it does sometimes happen. It doesn't have to be rape. People always think about rape, but it may not be that extreme. There's also financial exploitation. That's a big one. Someone who's misusing somebody's property, their funds, had them forge a check. Had them sign something they had no idea what they're signing. That happens often. I mean, that's probably the one that's on the rise the most, especially in the community. They think that's the highest type of abuse that's increasing. It's financial exploitation. There's also neglect. Neglect is I'm going to willfully deprive you of something that you need. Food, clothing, shelter, a basic need, medicine, care, basic care.
Fluids.
Fluids, right? And sometimes we hear the term self-neglect, where the person, maybe it's the senior living in the community, who's burning themselves with a stove or cigarettes or not taking their medicine, not bathing, not taking care of themselves. But sometimes it's neglect by others as well.
And I know this is more in the community, but an extreme case of neglect would be abandonment, where people are just dropped off.
Yeah.
And totally, you know, disregarded in terms of the care that they need and shelter and so on.
Yeah, you used to hear the term granny dumping at one time. People would literally dump somebody at the hospital and say, the emergency room, and say, I'm done. And they walk away and don't come back to pick up their loved one. So that has happened sometimes.
Well, we'll talk about the community-based issues in a separate show, but for today we're going to focus on the types of things that you see in the nursing home. Mm-hmm. And I think the first thing we should do is just talk about your role as an ombudsman, what exactly that means.
I know it's a strange word, isn't it?
It is. It's hard to say.
An ombudsman actually means like a citizen's representative, but in long-term care, we are an advocate. We are the residents' advocate for people who live in nursing homes and assisted livings. So any type of long-term care setting, it would not apply to someone who lives like in a senior independent housing. They have to live in either a nursing home or assisted living. And our role is to really be an advocate for that resident. We want to make sure they have quality of care and quality of life. Doesn't mean every place is perfect. They all have strengths and weaknesses, but we're there to be another set of ears and eyes and a voice for that resident.
And some of the things you do are investigating when people would report something, whether the patient themselves, the resident themselves, or family, or whatnot.
Yes, we do routine, what we call advocacy visits, just visit the facilities, just, you know, monthly, some of them are quarterly, but we also would get calls, and it can be from anybody. It can be anonymous, can be from the resident, the family, the staff, but if there's a concern about day-to-day issues, it could be food, you know, it could be the environment, could be anything really, the care, what have you. But in the regulations, it says that if there's an allegation of abuse, it has to be reported to the ombudsman if they live in nursing homes.
So the facility does not report it to the ombudsman. They report it to the state, or do they also report it to the ombudsman?
They report to the ombudsman. The facility themselves will do a self-report, and the regulations say they have to report it to the local law enforcement, to the police, to the Office on Aging, which is myself as the ombudsman, and to the state surveyors, Office of Healthcare Quality, that surveys the facility.
Well, let's talk about long-term care in general as well, because they house individuals that are vulnerable.
Yes.
Most of them are older, you know, 65 and older, although you do see some younger residents that, say, have multiple sclerosis or some sort of disease where they're younger and in a facility where they need total care.
Right.
But it's a very vulnerable population.
Oh, very.
And of course dementia. I'll let you expand on that.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen people as young as 19 and as old as 107 and anything in between. People are living longer. So some of the risk factors that make you more susceptible to abuse would be people who live older, the over 85 and older group, women, people with dementia, and guess what? If you're 85 or over, you have a 50% chance of having dementia. Mental health issues, substance abuse issues, and isolation is a big one. Isolation is also much a risk factor. You know, you might think, well, how can you be isolated if you're in a nursing home? There are people in nursing homes that don't have a loved one that comes to see them regularly. You know, they don't have, yes, the staff is there, yes, we're there, you know, once a month, but if a facility's got like 300 people in it, do I see 300 people every time I go? No. So there are people that don't have a lot of contact with a lot of other people in the community. So they might feel isolated. Do you know what I mean? They might really feel that way.
Well, not everyone in the nursing home has dementia, but a good number do. But they may have some kind of physical problem where they can't just get up and walk and travel about like they normally would.
They're dependent upon the staff for help. They're dependent upon that call bell. Answering that call bell and getting the assistance they need for the daily activities of life. Yes, they very much so.
Well, I know this may be a bit general, but let's just talk about what would be some of the signs and symptoms of abuse. And I know it depends on the type of abuse that occurred.
Right.
But
well, physical, it might be. What I hear a lot of times is like rough handling. They feel like they're just being treated kind of fast, like they're having to go through the motions, and it's kind of fast and rough handling. Sometimes we've seen bruises in unusual places, like on the breast, or in private areas. Not your typical place you would see a bruise. People think of the fingerprint bruise on a hand, but or arm, but it's not always that.
But unexplained, obviously.
Unexplained. You know. Injuries of unknown origin, right? All of a sudden the GNA comes in, there's a blackness under the eye that wasn't there the day before. Had that happen. And it might have been, a lot of times they'll do an internal investigation, it might have been that resident hit the bed rail. They had a fall. Something happened that caused that injury. Doesn't mean it's abuse. Just means the nursing home has to be able to explain what happened and investigate it.
Sometimes skin tears. You see skin tears with the rough handling?
Yeah. Skin tears, because their skin is so thin a lot of times, and they're on blood thinners, and they're just a high risk for that. Mm-hmm. But again, that skin tear might have been just from simple everyday thing, trying to take care of them, and it happened. It wasn't necessarily abuse.
Right. They're accidents.
Exactly. Accidents do happen. Verbal, sometimes you see people that are just, they're all of a sudden withdrawn. They're not talking as much. They're not going to activities. They're staying in their room more. They're afraid to speak up. People are afraid to speak up. And I understand that. Because, you know, they'll say, you know, I live here. I'm here 24/7. You're not here all the time. And they're right. They're right. And they're afraid. We try to empower. Big role of the ombudsman is to empower people. Educate and empower. Because they feel like they don't have that voice and they can't speak up. And if they do, they're afraid they get retaliated against. They'll say, well, if I say anything, I'll be labeled, or they won't answer my call bell, or I'll get this reputation here, and, you know, I got to live here. People are afraid to speak up.
I mean, what do you think is the estimated numbers of abuse? And we know they're underreported for the very reasons you mentioned.
Depending upon the data you look at, a few years ago they said that 1 in 14 cases were reported. Now they're saying it's 1 in 10. Some reports say 1 in 5. But at any rate, if there's 1 in 5 reported, that means there's 4 that are not. You know, I think it's gotten better over the past 15, 20 years. I think people are just more awareness about the problem. And there are events we have, like the World Elder Abuse Awareness Day, and things to make more of awareness of it and getting information out there. You see things on TV. You know, there's just stuff by Legal Aid. There's things out there to help educate people. So I think knowledge is power. I think people understand more about it, but I think we've got a long way to go.
Right, yeah. Let's talk first about the knowledge piece for the person that feels like they're being abused, or the family member that may suspect it. There are signs everywhere in nursing homes, it seems. The state requires it, you know, about who to contact if you suspect a problem with neglect or abuse. So tell us kind of what happens, you know, when that ball gets rolling and how you play in that picture.
Okay. Well, the nursing home, if they have an allegation, again, they have to write up an incident report, start the internal investigation. They're required to report it to, again, the three entities I mentioned: local law enforcement, the local office on aging, which is myself as the ombudsman, through MAC Incorporated, and the state surveyors. Okay. Then they have like 5 working days to work out the investigation. And what I do is, when they call me, I, again, the resident's advocate. So I'm going to go there and talk to that resident and see what the resident wants. We talk to the resident, sometimes talk to the roommate, sometimes talk to other residents on that unit, depending on what the allegation is. Talk to some of the staff. Was it an isolated thing? You know, and I've had sometimes residents change their story. Sometimes they said one thing, and then 2 days later they said something different. So we're trying to kind of put the pieces together to see if it's verified or not verified. But even if it's not verified, my role as the ombudsman is to see, what does the resident want? And a lot of times the resident will say to me, you know, I don't want the GNA to lose her job or be fired, but I don't want them to care for me again either. Yeah. Sometimes they'll say, I don't want that specific person to provide my care. Or I'm a little leery, or make sure there's 2 people, have a buddy system, or something like that. I want to know what does the resident want as the best outcome of what they believe may happen. Because sometimes we can't verify it, but there's some doubt lingering. So sometimes I think the biggest role I do, one of the big roles is do in-service and training and education to the staff.
To the staff.
We do staff and services about elder abuse. You know, make them understand that verbal abuse doesn't have to be cursing, for example. You know, it could be what you're saying or how you say it. Or not answering that call bell in a timely fashion. It might be the perception of the resident. Maybe you're just having a bad day. You're mad at your kid and your husband, right? But you're laying it out on the resident, right? That displays anger. You know, what can we do? Who can you go to? Your supervisor, somebody, another coworker. Who can we talk to help educate and knowledge and prevent this from happening? What can we do to prevent it, to make things better for you? Because it's a hard field to be in. I mean, caregiving in a nursing home, it's not easy. And I think our nursing homes in our area, I think we're very fortunate. I think they give great care. I think most of them really try hard. They want the best for the residents. Things still happen sometimes. And then they try to do the right thing. They try to be proactive. And they try to, let's just say an aide is being accused of something. A lot of times that person will be suspended. They'll do an investigation. And if all the pieces put together, say the police, myself, state surveyors, and the facility themselves believe it did her happen, then they may terminate that employee. They usually do. And they report that person to the Board of Nursing. You know, because again, we don't want the person going from nursing home A to nursing home B and doing the same thing.
Right.
We don't want anyone to lose their job. That's certainly not the goal. But the goal is to make sure that there's good care being given to the residents. So a lot of times, they're not always verified. A lot of times they might put them on probation, give them some training, some in-services, customer relations and services, kind of monitor how they do. Maybe they're reassigned to another area. Sometimes a resident with dementia, I remember one time I had a resident who, the minute she first time she saw me, she freaked out. I think I reminded her of someone that she didn't like. And she automatically reacted towards me,
right,
just visiting her. So I'm just reminded of somebody in her past, and she didn't want me to go see her. So if I'm the aide providing care, or having to do hands-on care, and they react like that, you know, it's like, okay, maybe I get somebody else to do her care, or do a buddy system, or
right,
get somebody else. Because sometimes due to the dementia or psych issues, they can't always express why they don't like this person providing their care.
Yeah, there's tons of research to support that they may not remember your name, but they remember how you made them feel or some
right,
distant memory, and it's very real to them.
Oh,
and
yes.
I mean, of course, with dementia care, it's very challenging, you know, because they themselves can become confused and agitated. And for nursing home employees, you know, it can be tough day after day to come in and take care of people. I mean, that never makes abuse right, but,
right,
you know, a lot of times you're right, they just need training on exactly what it is or what you should do if you're starting to feel frustrated,
right,
you know, who to talk to or leave the room or, you know, and for some people, long-term care may not be, you know, the right place for them to work too, and
yeah,
they just have to figure that out.
Yeah, a lot of times people just need to go away for 10 or 15 minutes and then try to come back again or to reapproach, or it could be against somebody else altogether. But a lot of times these are behaviors of the disease process that the resident's doing. So sometimes we see, you know, the resident reacting to the staff person. Sometimes it's the staff person to the resident. Sometimes it's resident to resident. And again, sometimes it's abuse if they're alert and oriented, know what they're doing. Sometimes it's just a behavioral symptom of that dementia or that psych diagnosis that caused them to act out, or a traumatic brain injury, or there's many physical diagnoses and diseases that can cause someone to react a certain way. And sometimes it's just staff not knowing how to respond to it, you know. And it is challenging. I mean, it's really challenging having different age groups, different diagnoses together. What's the best thing to do? And none of the facilities can provide one-on-one. I mean, sometimes family members say, well, you know, I'm paying you, just put them one-on-one. Well, they might do that for a short term, but not for a long period of time. They just can't.
Well, there can be some serious staffing challenges, you know, on certain days in nursing homes if there's call-ins or whatnot. I mean, no excuse, but, you know, it can be tough. It happens, you know, in most healthcare facilities.
Yeah.
Where you don't have optimal staffing all the time, too, and people feel stretched thin.
Yeah. And we have limited on Eastern Shore. We just don't have the Jerry psych care that we need. The resources that we need a lot of times are on the Western Shore of Maryland. So sometimes people get sent to the Western Shore for a short-term stay and come back, but family members don't like that, which I understand.
Right.
It's hard not having your loved one nearby.
And it's going to get, you know, more of a demand taking care of older adults as baby boomers age.
Oh, yes.
Now, do you ever have instances with visitors coming into facilities and that's reported as well?
We have. I've had a couple cases where one time a visitor was just inappropriately speaking to their loved one, you know, yelling, berating, the whole floor could hear it. So it caused a domino effect, you know, with the other residents too. I've had verbal abuse.
So who reported that? The facility staff or whatever?
Yep, they did. The staff was trying to protect their resident.
Right.
We had a visitor one time who inappropriately touched a resident that they used to have a relationship, but now the resident was in a comatose type state, could not give consent or permission. And they made aware what was happening. So they reported that.
Well, that is really being vulnerable then.
Very.
And of course, you need someone to advocate for you.
Yes, yes. So. And the staff was doing that. They were reporting that, making people aware, because really, they do love and care for the residents. They really do.
Yeah, there's no way. I mean, honestly, I think we have a lot of solid nursing homes, good nursing homes in the area. But we do know in a small percentage these cases do occur. But the most important thing is the knowledge, the education, and reporting them promptly.
Yes, the sooner the better. You know, we've had some cases where it got reported kind of late. And then what happens again, someone with dementia, they might forget and say, well, oh, yeah, I could tell you today really clearly what happened. And then 3 days later, they're not sure. You know, well, yeah, I think that happened. Or, well, I thought it was this person, but maybe it was this person. They sometimes don't forget. They forget.
And sometimes I guess they have second thoughts or want to change their mind about whether they really want to bring this out into the open.
Yes. Again, because they're living there.
Right.
You know, they're living there. Sometimes they're afraid to speak up. I think empowerment is something that we just don't do enough of. We try to talk about it. Resident councils in the facilities themselves, they have resident councils, family councils. They have groups that meet, and we try to talk to them as the ombudsman as well to empower the resident. If you think you have a problem, please tell your aide. Please tell that nurse. It will get to the administration. They'll do the proper follow-up and steps necessary to investigate. We take it very seriously. Any type of allegations against that resident.
Right. Well, such an important topic and issue and such an important job you have here on the shore to investigate and monitor for this type of thing. So again, we'll wrap up. You know, what are some important things you want our viewers to know about elder abuse, particularly as it relates to the nursing home setting?
Well, I think people need to know that it can occur. It can occur to anyone, really, at any time, at any place. And people think, oh, what happened to me, or I'd never do that. But the burdens and stress of caregiving can be very challenging. A few years ago, Mickey Rooney, remember Mickey Rooney?
Sure.
Yeah, he has since passed on, but he was a very popular, you know, actor. And just a few years ago, he himself testified to the Senate and congressional hearings saying, I was a victim of financial exploitation. If it can happen to Mickey Rooney, it can happen to anybody. And it was a family member in his own family that he gave testimony and was kind of left in the dark for 8 or 10 years. And a lot of his money was taken, was gone. And he wasn't even aware it happened. So my point is that all these different types of abuse, whether it be physical, verbal, sexual, the financial, the neglect, it can happen. And we need to be aware of the types and make sure we speak up.
Right.
And to be aware of our seniors, you know, in facilities. If you volunteer, I love having volunteers. I actually have four volunteer ombudsmen as well.
Oh, dear.
I'm the only employed ombudsman. I have four volunteers. But there are a lot of volunteers that go into nursing homes and assisted livings. That's great.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the family might live in California or Iowa and get here once or twice a year. So it's nice to have other people come in and see these people and talk with them and share and listen. Because they might tell you something you would think, really, what that happened? Well, when in doubt, please report it. Please tell somebody. We find out about things in the community through Meals on Wheels runs, that type of thing. But again, there's altogether nursing homes in our area. There's almost 1,400 beds, 1,400 residents in our four county area that we serve at MAC. It's a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Can't see them all. You know, so we really need families and friends of these residents to be advocates as well.
Do you identify people that you know don't have family anymore because they've lived such a long life that they no longer have family or friends? And because to me, they would be particularly vulnerable.
They are. And the activities directors in nursing homes, they know who they are.
Oh, okay.
I tell you how she knows. You go into the rooms and you don't see any personal items up the wall or in their bed or, you know, it's just the nursing home stuff, right? Nursing home calendar, basic bed.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see the stuffed animals and the pictures and the personal touches.
Right.
That might be someone who doesn't have family or, again, the family lives away. So, yeah. And then some people have legal guardians. We know who they are as well. But it does make them very vulnerable. Again, aging as the longer they live. I think it's really important for the staff to know themselves what to do to help themselves, to really educate the staff to get support they need. They need support. They need encouragement from their administration on down for the work they do. And we try to promote that. We try to encourage that. They have like National Nursing Home Week, and there's National Nurses Week, and National GNA Week, all kinds of things. And we just had on June 15th, World Elder Abuse Awareness Day, because that's to get more awareness. This is the 11th year now. They've done it worldwide to make people aware of the issues and who to report it to.
Well, Cheryl, thank you so much for coming in and talking about this important but difficult topic. But it's very important that we're all more aware of it and what it is and when to report it, how and promptly. And really appreciate you coming in.
Well, thank you.
To discuss it. We're also going to post some websites, information on MAC, and also a few other websites where people can get more information on the topic.
Oh yeah, knowledge is power. And I think the more information we have out there, let people know what's available and resources, look up or give me a call. We greatly appreciate that.
Well, thanks again.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us for this edition of Focus on Health here on PAC 14.